Ah, dans un lit de bourrac, jolie fille chérie. Oh, j'aime mon souvenir, mérite pas ça.
Hi, I'm Sam Monroe, and I'm president of the Port Arthur Historical Society. We own and operate the Museum of the Gulf Coast in partnership with the City of Port Arthur. And I'm here today in the Music Hall of Fame to talk about some of the people who are on exhibit here in the permanent exhibit. A lot of people ask, why are there so many people from this area who were successful in music? And the answer is probably not known to anybody, but you could maybe speculate about some of the possibilities. One is that you have talent in the area. People could sing, they could write, they could play instruments. We also had people in the area who were willing to invest in the talent here to record these personalities. You had Huey P. Moe from Winnie, Bill Hall from Beaumont, Pappy Daly in Houston, Floyd Swallow in Ville Platte. And the list goes on, including J.D. Miller in Crowley and George Currie in Lake Charles. These personalities were recorded, and the radio stations were willing to play them, another element in the success. Then our nearness to Houston and nearness to Lake Charles and ultimately New Orleans gave the entertainers a chance to promote their recordings in these major entertainment areas in major cities. And there, the doors open once you got on the radio or get your song played in one of the major cities like Houston or New Orleans. So music has been a big part of our fabric here in our community. This is a confluence area, the mixing of the Old South with the Southwest. To talk more about music, if you're going to discuss commercial music, it's necessary to mention Elvis Presley. He had such a big impact on recorded music and opened the door for so many entertainers, including the group that we're going to talk about today from southeastern Texas and southwest Louisiana. Presley, as everybody remembers, was a local act playing in Memphis and in some southern venues. He had a unique style. He was a nice-looking man. His bluesy voice gave him a certain command. When he did a song, it really became his own song. His first recording in 1954 was a cover on a rhythm and blues tune called That's All Right Mama. That record got on the air and made some noise in the South, but didn't sell so big. His second song was a tune called Good Rockin' Tonight. It got airplay, but no sales. The third release was You're a Heartbreaker. That one again got on the radio, but didn't sell very much outside of some southern markets. Presley was living with his mother and father in Memphis. They had lived in a public housing project, and as he began to play dates and make money, they were able to move to a single-family residence. And it had all the conveniences that you would expect in a city, except for a telephone. They had to borrow the telephone next door. His fourth release caused that relationship next door to become a little bit strained, because the fourth release was a song called Baby, Let's Play House. It entered the national charts and began to climb the country charts, ultimately reaching number 5 in the nation. His next release, his fifth release, also, this was in 1955, was a song called Mystery Train. And many people know that song today. But the other side was called I Forgot to Remember to Forget. That song went all the way to number 1 and was Presley's first number 1 recording on the country charts. He didn't make any dent in the pop charts. At the time, the major record labels had a stable of entertainers, artists, on their roster. And they'd release a single every 3 or 4 months. And then if they had a big hit, they'd release an album later in the year. RCA, Columbia, Brunswick, Decca. There were a lot of major companies at that time. The independent companies were like Sun Records in Memphis, had a very limited distribution, principally with Sun Records in the South. The independents and the national labels sort of stayed out of each other's way. However, with Presley making so much of a dent in sales, he came to the attention of RCA. They decided ultimately to sign him and break the precedent and put a local act on a national label. They recorded him and released a single, and the song was called Heartbreak Hotel. That single became a platinum record, which meant it sold 2 million copies almost overnight. That was unheard of. There hadn't been a platinum record awarded by the Record Industry Association of America in all the years that that designation existed. Presley's record set all kinds of other records. RCA decided to go ahead and release an album on a brand new artist that nobody had ever heard of. They did so. They took some of the cuts he had recorded at Sun Records and mixed them with material that he had recorded, principally covers of rhythm and blues songs. That album sold 1 million copies. No record album had ever sold 1 million copies. In his first year with RCA, Presley put 17 records in the national pop charts. So having said all that, this changed the record industry. It opened the door for people from our part of the country to record, get their material played, and then entertain a lease agreement with national labels. And Mercury Records paid particular attention to this area, and many of our acts here were picked up by Mercury. I want to talk first about Jivin' Gene Bourgeois. Gene grew up in Port Arthur, went through Catholic schools here, and was playing sock hops and local union halls and clubs in this area. He came to the attention of Huey P. Moe. Moe actually was a barber who lived in Winnie. Moe liked the sound and was fascinated with the horn section, and so they decided to record a tune, and they did so at KPAC Radio at 1515 Lakeshore Drive in Port Arthur. That building is currently a part of the campus of Lamar State College, Port Arthur. And the station stayed on the air till midnight. They went off at midnight. They'd come back on at 5 in the morning. So Gene and his band came in and set up and made the recording after the station had gone off the air. The band was set up in what we used to call Studio A in the radio station. The drums, the guitars, the bass, everything was ready to go. So they did a quick run through on Going Out with the Tide. This was a song Gene had written, inspired by Fats Domino's recording of Going to the River. The problem was that you could hear all the band instruments, but you couldn't hear the singer. So somebody said, well, let's run an extension cord down the hall into the men's restroom and run that cord down there and hook up Jivin' Gene's earphone so he can hear what's going on and give him a microphone. So that's what they did, and it worked. The recording turned out fine. You had good sound separation, and you could hear the artist perform the tune. The other side was a novelty song that Gene had written called Up, Up, and Away. The record got enough attention and got on the air locally, began to sell records. Bono Record Store in Port Arthur on Gulfway was a principal record sales outlet at that day and time. And Mrs. Bono was very interested in promoting local music. So she helped artists get their material played in front of jukebox operators, which was a major outlet for material, recorded material. Gene's record got on the jukebox and people liked it. There was enough backing for it that Huey Moe decided to take Gene to a real recording studio. This time they went to Crowley, Louisiana, to J.D. Miller's studio. Gene had written another song. This song was called Breaking Up Is Hard to Do. This one would get in the charts, not only locally, regionally, but nationally. See if you remember this one. Breaking up is hard to do.
Breaking up is hard to do. Breaking up is sad and blue. Making up is the thing to do. Don't you know what I see is true? Like I told you once before, this fussing and fighting there'll be no more. I will make this promise to you, just to prove my love is true.
That's Jivin' Gene. He's still out there and still performs, mainly in the South, but of late he's had invitations to go to the United Kingdom, where he's also performed. He had other hits, including Release Me and a new updated version of Going Out with the Tide. George Jones is one of the most successful recording artists of all time, particularly in the country field. Some historians place him as number two on the all-time list of great country performers, Eddie Arnold being the one ahead of him, and Johnny Cash being one behind him. Jones was born in Saratoga, Texas, in East Texas, right outside the Big Thicket. As a kid, his family moved to Beaumont, and he grew up in Beaumont. George had an ability to sing, and he was encouraged by his father. He learned to play the guitar and began to perform. He started working with an evangelist who would do tent shows, revival shows in various cities. He came to Port Arthur with the evangelist and performed here. He met a young woman while he was here, and they began a friendship that resulted in their getting married. Her name was Dorothy Bonvillian. She lived on 19th Street in Port Arthur, and her father was a banker at the First National Bank. George played the guitar and didn't work, but they did marry, and the father encouraged him to stop playing the guitar and find a job. The couple was living with the banker and his wife. George did get a job as a house painter. He didn't like that too well. He made enough money, though, for he and his bride to move into an apartment on their own. Things didn't work out over time, and he decided to join the military. It was during the Korean War, and George went to Korea. He was honorably discharged and came back. He had gotten a divorce, and he began to look for a music career full-time. He found a song called Why Baby Why and recorded it with Pappy Daly in Houston and Bill Hall as his manager. And that song got in the national country charts. That led to other hits, but his first number one was a song called White Lightning. This tune had been written by J.P. Richardson. And we're going to talk quite a bit about J.P. I'll tell you more about him in a minute. But listen to this song, White Lightning.
Well, in North Carolina, way back in the hill, lived my old pappy, and he had him still. He brewed a white lightning till the sun went down. Then he filled him a jug and he'd pass it around. Mighty, mighty pleasing, and pappy's corn squeezing.
Shh, white lightning.
Well, a G-man team and a river nurse too, searching for a place where he made his brew. They were looking, trying to book him, but my pappy kept a cooking.
Shh, ooh, white lightning.
Well, I asked my old pappy why he called his brew. White lightning, said
the Mountain Dew. I took a little sip and right away I knew as my eyes bugged out in my face.
That was a big record and opened a lot of doors for George Jones. He would go on to put 165 records on the national country charts in his career, and he would sing the song that most people consider the best country song of all time, He Stopped Loving Her Today. Johnny Carville formed a band called The Shades. Johnny would later change his name to Johnny Preston. They played the sock hops and local dances around town and around the area and became quite popular. Johnny had attended Catholic schools in Port Arthur, and he was well known and well thought of. Johnny actually had a tremendous singing voice. On one of the occasions when he was performing at a club in Port Neches, Bill Hall from Beaumont, who was a record producer, and J.P. Richardson, who was a well-known disc jockey, came out to hear him, and they liked the way he sounded. J.P. had written a song and wanted to introduce the song to Johnny Preston and to see if he would be willing to record it. So they played a tape in one of the back rooms of the club on one of the breaks of the song, and Johnny listened to it. The name of the song was Running Bear. Johnny didn't think the song fit his voice or his style. The song to him was more like a novelty tune. So he didn't say no, but he was rather skeptical of it. Johnny actually had a multi-octave range and could really hit those high notes that other singers could not. He had a naturally trained voice. J.P. picked up on that and said, well, you know, look, this song is going to be a hit for somebody. It may as well be a hit for you. So Johnny reconsidered and said, okay, I'll record the tune. They decided on a date. They went to Houston and recorded it. The song didn't turn out well in the recording session. There were some errors made. So 2 weeks later, they went back and recorded it again. This time, everybody was satisfied with their performance. Johnny then went back to working his day job. He worked as a clerk in the federal building in Port Arthur for the National Guard office. He had married, and he had a son, a small child at home. That job in the National Guard office gave him a regular paycheck that he needed right then. One day, Bill Hall, the manager, called him and said, you know, Mercury Records has picked up your song, and it's beginning to sell. There's a record buyer who buys for jukeboxes in St. Louis who just placed an order for 15,000 copies of Running Bear. I need you out on the road promoting this song. So Johnny was reluctant to leave a job with his obligations at home, but finally did quit the job as a clerk in the National Guard office and went on the road to promote the song Running Bear. Here it is.
On the bank of the river stood Running Bear, young Indian brave. On the other side of the river stood his lovely Indian maid. Little white dove was of her name, such a lovely sight to see. But their tribe but with each other, so their love could never be. Running Bear, love little white dove, with a love big as the sky. Running Bear, love little white dove, with a love that couldn't die. He couldn't swim the raging river.
Johnny would have other hits. He would put 5 records in the national charts and have a great career. Many of his successful songs were in the United Kingdom and Europe. So he spent a lot of time touring in those areas, more so than in the United States. We lost Johnny a few years ago, but his music lives on. We've been talking about J.P. Richardson, but most of you probably know him better as the Big Bopper. He was a songwriter. He had written a song for Benny Barnes called Poor Man's Riches that had been a hit. We had mentioned that he had written White Lightning for George Jones. Incidentally, he performed one of the Indian sounds on Running Bear himself. And Jones also performed on Running Bear. And the Big Bopper put in the line White Lightning in the Jones hit. So I mean, he was all over the place, singer, writer, and all. He was a disc jockey at KTRM in Beaumont, 990 on the AM dial. That station was oftentimes ranked number one, and principally because of the Big Bopper. He had an afternoon drive time show that was very popular. Bill Hall was his manager. Marge Hall, Bill's wife, is a good friend and still lives in the area. She's the one who told me this story, and I think it's an interesting story to tell you today. They were going to go to Houston to record the Big Bopper. And the Big Bopper was sort of an alter ego that J.P. used on the air. And Bill Hall said to him, said, you know, why don't you record something that the Big Bopper might record, you know, what, your alter ego. He said, well, I'd really like to record a song called The Witch Doctor Meets the Purple People Eater. And Bill thought, well, you know, that song sounds like a novelty tune. I'm not too sure about it. But he said, okay, well, let's try that. But what are you going to put on the other side of the record? And the Bopper said, well, I think I'll put maybe a Hank Williams song on. Everybody loves Hank Williams. He said, well, why don't you put on something original? I've heard you talking about a tune that you did where this guy is talking to a chick on the telephone. And, you know, take it from there. So he decided to go ahead and try that. They're driving on Highway 90. This is before I-10 was finished. And they got to Liberty. And at that point, J.P. had finished writing the song that he's going to put on the other side of his novelty tune. He was also carsick, so he and Marge Hall traded places in the car, and they went into Houston and recorded this tune. See if you remember, Chantilly Lace.
Hello, baby. Yeah, this is the Big Bopper speaking. Do I want? Will I want? Oh, baby, you know what I like. Chantilly lace and a pretty face and a ponytail hanging down, wiggling the walk and a giggling the talk. Make the world go round. Ain't nothing in the world like a big-eyed girl to make me act so funny, make me spend my money, make me feel real loose like a long-necked goose, like a girl. Oh, baby, that's what I like.
That song was a hit for other people, including Jerry Lee Lewis. Chantilly Lace, the Big Bopper. Sadly, we lost the Bopper with Buddy Holly and Ritchie Valens at a terrible plane crash. The Port Arthur Historical Society and some of the supporters of the Big Bopper placed a historical Texas marker on his grave in Beaumont. Everybody misses the Bopper. Ivory Joe Hunter was born in Kirbyville, Texas. He grew up there but moved to Port Arthur. He was one of 14 children born to a Baptist minister and his wife. Ivory Joe joined a brother here. His name was Joe. Ivory Joe, that was his given name. He already had a brother named Joe, so they called him Ivory Joe. He graduated Lincoln High School, as I mentioned, in Port Arthur. He began to play on the radio on KFDM in Beaumont and KPAC in Port Arthur. He played the piano and he wrote songs. He left the area and went to California, where he found more acceptance for his music. He wrote a song in 1949 called I Almost Lost My Mind. That tune went into the national charts on the rhythm and blues side and went all the way to number one. Pat Boone would discover that song and record it and have a number one hit for it in his career. Ivory Joe came along in 1956 with another song. This one was called Since I Met You, Baby. And this one went all the way into the top 10 on the pop charts, which was a significant accomplishment in his career. About this same time, he wrote a song called My Wish Came True. And he was acquainted with Elvis Presley. At this time, Ivory Joe was living in Memphis. On one occasion, according to the disc jockey in Tennessee there, George Klein, who was a longtime Presley friend, Klein took Ivory Joe to Elvis's home at Graceland, where Ivory Joe introduced the song and played it on the piano there, My Wish Came True. Presley liked it so much that he recorded it right away, and it would be released while he was in the military and go to the top 10 in the United States and the United Kingdom. Well, let's listen now as we go back to Ivory Joe's major hit on all the pop charts, Since I Met You, Baby.
Since I met you, baby,
Arthur Historical Society placed a Texas State marker on the grave of Ivory Joe Hunter. He's buried at Magnolia Springs outside of Kirbyville. And one more thing now, let's hear Elvis sing My Wish Came True.
My wish came true. And served my whole life through.
My whole life through.
There's just one thing.
There's just one thing.
Here before we start.
Before we start.
Don't say.
Clifton Chenier grew up in the sugarcane fields near Opelousas, Louisiana. At the time, Port Arthur was expanding its oil refineries. Gulf Oil, Texaco were hiring a lot of people. A lot of them came from Louisiana. Clifton's father got a job at Gulf Oil, so the family moved to Port Arthur. When Clifton and his brother Cleveland were old enough, they got hired in the labor gang at Gulf Oil. Oftentimes, on the lunch hour, they would come and bring their instruments along with them and play sort of relaxed during lunch. It got to where Clifton could make more money in tips at lunch than he could working all day in the labor gang. So he decided to quit his job and play music full time. He would go on to have national hits, and he would be given credit for inventing and perfecting what is today known as Zydeco music. Here's Clifton Chenier with one of his biggest hits, Hey Tiffy.
Hey Tiffy, hey Tiffy,
Hampton had a great career and brought his son into the musical organization. C.J. Chenier started playing with his father when he was 15 years old and began touring with him. C.J. Chenier, who's also a member of the Hall of Fame today, goes out on tour and plays many of the cities and dates that his daddy played before him. Harry Choate is considered a Cajun performer who was a groundbreaking performer. His song, Joe LeBlanc, is considered the Cajun national anthem. He did release that song, which had been a folk song, an old tune, but he rearranged it and put amplified instrumentation behind it. Harry grew up in South Louisiana. He was born in a small community there called Cow Island. His mother was unable to secure a physician or midwife to assist her when his birth came, and she was assisted by a local veterinarian. Harry got off to kind of a slow start, but his mother came to Port Arthur where she found work, and Harry came with her. He began to play and sing on the streets on Proctor Street, which was a bustling business center at that time, and he would play for tips. He attended Port Arthur public schools, but did not finish. But he had an extraordinary ability to play a guitar, taught himself, and play the fiddle. He taught himself to play. Harry's tune, Joe LeBlanc, went into the national charts. It was the first Cajun record to enter the national charts in the late 1940s. He was in demand all over the South and had a huge career and drew big crowds everywhere he played. Sadly, he wound up an alcoholic and was found dead while in custody in an Austin City jail. But the song lives on today. Here it is, Joe LeBlanc. A few years back, Harry's grave was decorated by placing a Texas State historical marker on his grave. He had been buried, laid there in a pauper's grave. That plaque tells of his career and the significance of his song, Joe LeBlanc. Lee Hazelwood grew up in Port Neches and went on into the military service during the Korean War time. He came back and got a radio job in Tucson, Arizona. While he was out there, he got involved in playing some music and managed some local groups, and then actually recorded a couple of performers from that area. He got to be well known as a record producer and went up the ladder in the recording industry, as taking a position as an executive at Jamie Guyden Records in Philadelphia. He had written a song that he thought might be good for someone like Nancy Sinatra. The background on the song is there was a club, a private club, on Gulfway Drive in Port Arthur called the Golden Cask. And Lee enjoyed going in there and having a drink and having dinner. One night when he was sitting at the bar, there was a couple sitting a few places down from him. they got in some kind of a disagreement. And one of them said to the other one, "One of these days, I'm going to walk all over you." He thought, you know, there's something there. He wrote that line down on a napkin. And he began to think about how he could work that in to a song. The next day, he caught a plane for Los Angeles. And while he was on the plane, he finished writing the song. He presented it to Nancy Sinatra. She loved the song. He produced a recording on her, "These Boots Are Made for Walking."
You keep saying you got something for me, something you call love, but confess, you've been a messin' where you shouldn't have been a messin', and now someone else is getting all your best. These boots are made for walking, and that's just what they'll do. One of these days these boots are gonna walk all over you. Yeah. You keep lying when you ought to be truthing, and you keep losing when you ought to not bet. You keep saying when you ought to be a changing. Now what's right is right, but you ain't been right yet. These boots are made for walking, and that's just what they'll do. One of these days these boots are gonna walk all over you.
Lee and Nancy Sinatra would have several hits together and enjoyed touring the country as a duo. Robert Guidry was a young man who grew up in Abbeville, Louisiana. He began playing with a local band when he was 15 years old. And they played the local clubs and the local school dances and all. On one of these occasions, after they had played, Bobby and the band went to get a hamburger after midnight at a local diner. And while they were there, Bobby noticed there was a couple sitting nearby having a good time. Bobby had a phrase that he would use as he would leave. He would say, "Well, I'll see you later, alligator." Just something he said, just a colloquialism that he used. So on this occasion, he's walking away from his bandmates and he says, "See you later, alligator." And the woman with this other man nearby said, "After a while, crocodile." And Bobby said, "I heard that," but he said, "I wasn't sure." So he said, "I went back and apologized and said, what did you say to me?" And she repeated, "After a while, crocodile." Bobby immediately saw that this had a song in it. "See you later, alligator. After a while, crocodile." He went home and wrote the song that very night. He was 15 years old. He did take the song to his band. They did start performing it. And he wound up in New Orleans at Cosmo Matassa's recording studio where they recorded the song. And Chess Records in Chicago liked it so much, they released it. Bobby's version didn't do all that well, but another fella out there was looking for a follow-up to a monster hit, Rock Around the Clock, a guy named Bill Haley. Bill Haley recorded See You Later, Alligator, and it went to number 2 in the United States and the United Kingdom. And here it is.
Well, I saw my baby walking we
she told me nearly made me lose my head. When I thought of what she told me nearly made me lose my head. But the next time that I saw her, reminded her of what she said.
See you later, alligator.
Bobby would go on to have a significant career and write songs for many artists that became hits. But one of his favorites was Fats Domino. He wrote several hits for Fats, but one of them is memorable. Even though Fats had 65 hits, this one stands out. It's called Walking to New Orleans. The way Bobby talks about writing that song is he was down on his luck, and he went to hear Fats play at a club in Lafayette. A friend had driven him there because Bobby had lost his car and didn't have money, was living at home again, couldn't afford anything. But he went backstage because he had known Fats, they'd been acquainted in New Orleans. Fats said, "Look, Bobby, come see me. I want you to come hang out with me in New Orleans." And Bobby said, "Fats, I can't get anywhere. I couldn't go. The only way I could get there would be if I walked." He said, right away, there was something there that sounded like a song. So as his friend was driving him home after talking to Fats, he started on writing with a pencil and paper and wrote the song, Walking to New Orleans. And here it is.
This time I'm walking to New Orleans. Get through walking these blues when I get back to New Orleans. I've got my suitcase in my hand. Now ain't that a shame? I'm leaving here today. Yes, I'm going back home to stay. Yes, I'm walking to New Orleans.
We want to close this session out today talking about Janis Joplin. Janis, as everybody knows, grew up in Port Arthur. She had a rough time growing up, as most teenagers do. She did graduate from Thomas Jefferson High School and went on to college at Lamar University in Beaumont. And she left there to go to the University of Texas in Austin. She began to play music as she grew older. When she was here, she sang mostly folk songs. She was fascinated with the folk music scene of that day and time. She was also interested, however, in blues performers like Billie Holiday and jazz performers, Ella Fitzgerald, people of that time in the 1940s and early 50s. Janis realized at some point when she was in Austin that she could sing the blues, and she had a voice that gave her a sound that other people were not able to make at that time. She had the ability to sing a song and make it her own song. And she began to perfect that when she moved to California and began working regularly with Big Brother and the Holding Company. Janis found her way there and began to record first for the mainstream label. That was not a successful recording session. They didn't know how to get her on tape. But then she went over to Columbia and began to record songs that are famous today and are still selling to this day. One of these songs is a song written by Kris Kristofferson. Kris was a very prolific songwriter from Brownsville, Texas. His father had been in the military and he had moved around a great deal, but he had a great sense for music and lyrics. At the time Kris Kristofferson wrote the song Me and Bobby McGee, he was working out of Morgan City, Louisiana, as a helicopter pilot servicing the offshore industry there. He began to work with a record company in Nashville. Fred Foster had a company called Monument Records. He thought Kris could write and was encouraging him. One of their telephone calls, Fred said, "You know, I know a secretary, and her name is Bobby McGee. Why don't you see if you can write a song about Bobby McGee?" So Kris took that inspiration and began to write. His real goal in life was to be a songwriter and to write a successful song for Johnny Cash. He wrote the song, Me and Bobby McGee, and gave it to Fred Foster to shop it around, see if Cash would take it. Cash turned it down. But Roger Miller liked the song and recorded it. His song would enter the charts on the country charts and go up to be a top 20 hit for the man they often called Roger Dodger Motor Scooter Miller. Janis was in Tennessee and Nashville looking for material and came across Roger Miller's recording. She liked the song so much, she wanted to do her version of it. Here is an acoustic sampling of her version of Me and Bobby McGee.
Busted flat in Baton Rouge, waiting for a train, and this feeling is faded as my jeans. Bobby thumbed a diesel down just before it rained. It rode us all the way into New Orleans. I pulled my harpoon out of my dirty red bandana, and I was playing soft while Bobby sang the blues, yeah. Windshield wipers slapping time eyes, holding Bobby's hand in mine, we sang every song that Daddy knew. Freedom's just another word for nothing left to lose. Nothing, don't mean nothing, hon, if it ain't free. Yeah, and feeling good was easy, Lord. Bobby sang the blues. You know, feeling good was good enough for me.
We have a significant exhibit on Janis here in the Music Hall of Fame in the museum, including a replica of her car. Janis's career wound up bad for her, and she died of a drug overdose. That really was such a sad thing, to have someone with so much talent, so much ability. She was a writer, she was an artist, and she really had a lot of creative energy, but we lost her so soon. Janis has been remembered by more people than we know. She's in the Hall of Fame, Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. She's in the Hall of Fame here at the Museum of the Gulf Coast. She has a postage stamp with her image on it. There have been many books written about her life, even plays about her. Her fans continue to follow her, and those new fans, young people who didn't know her at all while she was living, continue to come to see what she lived, where she lived, and see the materials contained in our collection here at the museum. That's all the time we have today. Thanks a lot. See you soon.
La, 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 la.
Bobby.